Welcome back, everybody, to another episode. And in today's episode, we're going to be talking about that summer to fall transition and the areas that I'm going to be fishing and the baits that I'm going to be using on the river. All right, guys, so welcome back to yet another episode. And before I start this episode, 5,000 subscribers, we're doing a rod and reel giveaway. So if you guys want to be entered in that rod and reel giveaway, all you got to do is subscribe to the channel. We just hit 3,000 subscribers, so thank you guys for all of the support. I really, really appreciate every single one of you. I love the comments and the engagement from you guys. So super jacked about that, guys. I remember when I only had like just 100 subs. It's not a huge milestone, but to me it is. But we're so close to 5,000 subs, just 2,000 away. So if you're not subscribed to the channel, go ahead, subscribe. You could win a free rod and reel combo. So like I said, guys, we're gonna be talking about that summer to fall transition time. First off, we gotta talk about when exactly is that. Now, around here right now, the thing that I like to do is if I'm just, you know, gonna go out on the boat, I just keep an eye on the water temp with the electronics and just see when that really starts to start, you know, tapering off from, you know, the 80s down into the 70s and really tapering off. Once I start to see like consistent temperature drops from the electronics, that's when I know that the transition is happening. Another good way to tell that, guys, if you guys are, you know, if you don't have a boat and you're just fishing from shore and you don't have the luxury of electronics, like a few of these mornings I've had to throw on a sweatshirt in the mornings when I go outside. That's when you know the transition is happening, when you're starting to get, you know, those cooler summer nights where it's starting to be pretty, you know, a little chilly in the morning. That's when you know that you're starting to hit that fall transition. Now we're gonna talk about the areas that we're gonna be finding bass. Now, if you get out there at first light, especially during this transition, it can be hard to find those bass simply because it's cooling off. And with the water temps really cooling off, those bass just kind of, they're really sporadic. They're everywhere, okay? So that's the thing. When the water temp starts to drop, those fish spread out and they're searching for food to feed on. Early mornings, it can actually be kind of tough to find bass, especially during that transitioning time, because they're not concentrated, because the water temps haven't heated back up. They're nice and cool. They're out searching, roaming around and stuff like that. And that's where, like, it's almost when midday hits that it can actually be your best bite. Now, where am I going to be looking for fish during this period? Now, if you're on a lake, it's pretty simple. You know, generally during the fall transition, bait fish are going to start pushing shallow. They're going to start pushing into the backs of coves, the backs of bays, shallow bays, almost where, you know, those bass spawned, is kind of where they're going to be at. You're gonna find a lot of the bait fish pushing back into those shallow bays, those shallow pockets and everything, and that's where the bass are gonna go. The bass are gonna start schooling in this time, okay? You're gonna notice that, you know, a lot of bass are gonna start schooling up and they're really getting congregated together and targeting those bait fish. Some of you may have had this already, but I know last year myself, I've had phenomenal days in the fall time. I've had really tough days in this transition when you're trying to find fish and it's important to cover water. And I have some baits here that we'll talk about that are really good for covering water. And it can be tough to fish, but there's also gonna be those days in the fall time where it's gonna just be an amazing bite. They're just gonna be super schooled up, big schools of fish, and you're just gonna be catching them like that. It just doesn't seem like there's a bad lure you can throw, and they're gonna be hitting it. And that's just because they're gonna be following those bait fish up into those coves, up into those shallow bays, chasing those bait fish. And if you get in there and get to those spots when they're really feeding up on them, you can really have a productive day. Like I said, on lakes and stuff, I'm gonna look for those shallow bays, those shallow coves, those little inlets and stuff like that. That's where those bait fish are gonna push into, and that's where those bass are gonna head to. Now, we are gonna be talking about the river here because I do fish the Mississippi River quite a bit. So we're gonna be talking about some spots that are gonna be on a river that you're not gonna necessarily find on a lake. So one of the spots that I think is huge for fishing the river that you're gonna find only on rivers is good back eddies. And what I mean by that is you're gonna have a slough that's just, you know, the slough's pushing through good heavy water current, and then all of a sudden there's gonna be a back eddy swirling, okay? Up on the shoreline, there might be a little dip into the shoreline where a back eddy just pushes into, right? Now, why that spot in particular is so killer for fish, especially in the fall time, is it pushes those bait fish into those areas. And generally those areas are a little shallower and those bait fish get shoved in there from the current. Those bass will just school up in that back eddy, and they'll just sit there and ambush bait fish and just get shoved into there. And that can be a really good spot to find fish in the fall time. I mean, they're really gonna push into those back eddies, really feed up on all that bait fish that's just being pushed in there, because the bait fish can't really swim through that stuff. So they get shoved into those back eddies, and those bass just school up and feed up really hard right there. Another spot you might find on the river as well is you're gonna have a lot of sloughs and stuff that are gonna have a lot of good flowing water, and you're gonna have where a slough will come and then it'll turn sharp, almost like a 90 degree turn, or just a really sharp turn in the slough. And what's nice about that is it's gonna create a little bit of an eddy as well, but that flowing water coming through is gonna push bait fish into that corner, especially if it's good, like 90 degree turn pretty much in that slough. You're gonna have bait fish are gonna be shoved into that corner on that turn, and that's where you're gonna find some bass schooling as well. Bass will school up in them corners and wait for those bait fish to just get shoved in there, especially in the fall time. Now that we've discussed the areas that I'm going to be looking for bass in the fall time, we're gonna be talking about the baits that I use and why I use these specific baits in the fall time. One of my favorite baits to use in the fall time, guys, is gonna be a top water popper. Here is just like a chug bug here. It's an all white one. I use all different colors. You can hear that it rattles, actually. But what I love about a top water bait is, especially if you pull up into a cove, back eddy, anywhere, early morning or at any time of the day, and all of a sudden you see those bass busting on bait fish. You just see them coming out of the water, busting bait fish. You see balls of bait swimming around, getting chased. And one key thing you're gonna wanna look for is not only bass coming out of the water hitting them, but you're gonna wanna keep your eye out for a little, it almost looks like you took a little handful of pebbles of rocks and threw it into the water. You'll see that's what it'll look like, is bait fish jumping and being chased by bass. The bass might not be popping, but those bait fish are showing you that they're being chased. And if you can see that, you can throw these poppers right through the middle of those big balls of bait and stuff like that, and just get absolutely blown up by bass. And just especially in the fall time when they school up, you can throw this in there, pull one out, throw right back in and catch another one. I mean, they just school up and they go crazy, and these poppers do a great action of making it look like they're being chased and whatnot as well. And now my next bait is going to be a swim jig, guys. You know that I'm a diehard swim jig fan, guys. I like to use colors that are gonna represent bait fish, especially shad. I like to go with all white, white and chartreuse, you know, stuff like that. Pretty much white with a boot tail, you know, rage tail on there. Absolute killer bait for the fall time. And really this just resembles bait fish swimming pretty much the whole time, you know, and it's almost like your basic version of it. It's just gonna match the bait really well. A swim jig is just a killer bait on the Mississippi River, and I can't preach it enough. I fish a swim jig a ton. It resembles the bait that you're looking for, those bait fish, that shad, perfectly. You can't go wrong with the swim jig, and I love using a swim jig because I can cover a lot of water with this, guys. Now in the fall time, like I said, those water temps are cooling down and those fish are starting to push out and kind of, you know, navigate off of it a little bit and search around, and this, you could cover a lot of water with this swim jig. Now I have a couple little things here that we're going to talk about as well, that are pretty close to the swim jig as well, but I do tend to use these quite a bit during the fall time. And that's just going to be like a swim bait hook here, guys, and you just put a paddle tail, boot tail trailer on there, and this is really good for just matching the bait. And that's what you're trying to do in the fall time, is these fish are trying to feed up. They have to feed up. They have a biological clock that's telling them that they need to feed up. So you're really gonna need to match the hatch here. And these little swim bait hooks here, throwing on a little paddle tail, to work really well. These hooks as well, they have a little bait keeper, but they are weighted. You can see that big weight on that hook as well. These are weighted, and then you can twist that paddle tail on here, and it's weedless as well. But like I said, you're just matching the hatch, and these are both gonna look like, you know, bait fish, shad swimming through the water. Like I said, they have to feed up. These bass know winter's coming. They know that it's time to feed up. It's not like you're gonna go in there and throw a lure, and like you're going down the bank and throw a lure and you happen to put the lure in front of the fish's face and he eats it. That's not what this time of the year is. They're feeding up, they have to feed up. So when you get on a bite, it's because they're actively feeding to beef up for the winter. These two baits pretty much go hand in hand, but this is for one of those situations where I'm throwing a swim jig, I'm throwing a swim bait around, and I'm not getting bit. I know that there's fish busting in the area, but I'm not getting bit. Or I am getting bit, but I'm catching small fish and I wanna upgrade, I wanna upsize, I want bigger fish. That's when I'm gonna throw a spinner bait or a chatter bait. Now, the reason for that is the simple fact that these blades, okay? Now, when I throw a swim jig through that area, it's just basically getting that kick coming through with the trailer and the skirt kind of flashing, right? Now with this, it's gonna target those bigger fish. I may not get bit as much, but when the spinnerbait is coming through that big pack of shad or bait fish, and these blades are kicking, giving it that extra flash, that bigger fish is gonna see that. You want your bait to stand out amongst those bait fish that are swimming around, and especially with this or the chatterbait, mainly the spinnerbait, it just has those two blades that kick really well, they give off flash, that's gonna attract that bigger fish to get that bigger bite. Same with the chatterbait, it does have a blade on there, it's gonna give a little bit of flash, gonna give that vibration. I don't particularly use this color of spinnerbait. I generally use white, generally a shad color, sexy shad color, or chartreuse, mainly white, white and chartreuse, that's the colors I'm gonna go for. Spinnerbait, chatterbait, I'm definitely gonna use those when I'm trying to upsize and I'm not catching good quality fish, but I am catching fish, but it's not the quality that I want. I'm gonna switch over to the spinnerbait and chatterbait. Now for my last bait. Now this is gonna pertain to fishing a little deeper. Now on the Mississippi River, I don't fish a lot of deep stuff, pretty much at all. But there is gonna be some spots, some back eddies, like I mentioned before, that are deeper. I have one back eddy where that I know of where it really kicks in there, but it can get down to like 25 feet in some of the spots, like it really drops off. And when you're on the electronics, you can see those fish when they start to school up at that 20-foot mark, even if, 15 to 20 feet. So that's when I'm gonna switch over to fishing a crankbait. Can't go wrong with a crankbait. This is just the sexy shad colored crankbait. Big diver, it really gives a good rattle. Like I said, it's just gonna, you're matching the hatch. I mean, pretty much every bait I've had here, guys, is just matching the hatch. This is just for targeting those deeper bass. It's not gonna be very often on the river that I'm gonna fish that deep, but there is gonna be some situations that call for it. And that's when you gotta have the right bait for it. And crankbaiting, especially a big crankbait, sexy shad, is gonna do the trick for you. So there you guys have it. Those are pretty much the baits that I use. Now you'll notice that I didn't really list the finesse bait. In my opinion, if you're going to fish finesse, if you're not getting bit, nothing's working, you basically toss, I personally will go to fishing a Senko or a jig, but most of the time in the fall time, I'm trying to cover water in the early mornings and stuff like that. And once I find fish, because that's the big thing you're gonna be looking for, you're gonna be bouncing to all these areas where the fish should be schooling up. And you're gonna try out a bunch of areas and they're not gonna work. You're not gonna find fish. But that's what you do. You just have to keep moving around in the fall time until you find fish. Once you find fish, they're gonna be schooled up and you're gonna catch a good chunk of them. But a lot of these baits here are moving baits. They're gonna be for covering water. That's mainly what it's for. Trying to cover water, trying to find fish. If I get into an area where I found fish, but I'm not getting bit like I want to, that's when I start to kind of nitpick my lures a little bit. Like I said, shallow coves, shallow bays and stuff like that, that's where fish are gonna push into, back eddies, corners through a slough and stuff like that, stuff where bait fish are gonna be pushed into, and bass can sit up in ambush. That's pretty much where you're gonna want to focus on for your high percentage areas. I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. If there is some tips that I didn't list for the fall time that you guys love to use and I didn't list it, go ahead, share it in the comments below. If you guys have any questions, go ahead and ask them in the comments below as well. I'll do my best to answer them. Hope you guys enjoyed today's video. Remember to like and subscribe, and until next time, keep fishing on.